Hey, Senegal beat Colombia?
No, they beat
Poland.
Poland. I mean,
2-1.
Who was the earlier game? Japan.
30.
Wow. The Americas, man. Only Mexico and Uruguay are holding.
Colombia had a red card in the 3rd minute.
Terrible. What happened?
In the 3rd minute?
In the 3rd minute. Handball in front of the goal. Like, it was basically to save the goal. But I don't know if it's worth saving the goal to be down 8-7 minutes.
And out the next couple matches, too. When Suarez did it for Uruguay in 2010, it made sense because it was elimination.
Hey guys,
and they went to a penalty and they missed it.
Bye.
Ah, football. Foosball.
This is your captain speaking. We are making our descent into Las Vegas McCarran Airport. On behalf of our crew, we'd like to thank you for flying MMA Junkie Airlines. Now please fasten your seatbelts and put your tray tables in your upright position because the descent is going to be a little bit bumpy.
Alright, Junkie Nation, it's time to roll, baby, on MMA Junkie Radio with Gorgeous George and Ghost. This is what we do and why we do it, baby. All night long, we rollin'! Yes!
The MMA Junkie Radio revolution is upon us.
Can you dig it?
There's no escape. No escape. Through the vast frontier of cyberspace. And through a sea of stars in outer space.
One small step for man.
We've solidified our combat communication stranglehold.
We are controlling transmission.
With the use of MMA Junkie Radio and Sirius XM satellite radio technology. MMA Junkie Radio. Commence transmission. Live from MMA Junkie Radio HQ in the fight capital of the world, Las Vegas, Nevada. Here are your hosts, Gorgeous George and Goes.
From the fight capital of the world, inside the beautiful Mandalay Bay Race and Sportsbook, you are listening to the MMA Junkie Radio Show, the only show that matters. I'm your host, Gorgeous George. With me, as always, is the devious and dastardly Goes, our East co-host, back east, handling all the producing, Danny Otto, and our special in-studio guest, Duncan Fretch. On the far right, he's Vice President of Performance of the UFCPI and the Vice President of Athlete Development, but more importantly, a former world champion in the Ultimate Fighting Championship in the light heavyweight division, Forrest Griffin.
Hey.
What's up, guys?
How you doing?
Yeah, good. How about you?
Great. Doing well. Thanks for having us on.
The suits are here.
That was...
is that the intro?
We wore gym pants. That was quite the intro, though. Yeah.
It is important. Reaching the pinnacle is you know... It's definitely stealing something that always needs to be mentioned. You know what I mean? Like, former presidents, and they always have their secret service. I just think that no matter what, anybody that ever introduces you should state that.
Oh, no, I didn't mean my intro. I meant the intro to the show.
There's
a lot going on there.
Yeah. Do you recognize Burt Watson?
I mean, oh, yeah. I recognize Burt. Burt, not the Twilight Zone, but the other one.
Oh,
outer,
okay.
outer.
Yeah, it is a
Outer Limits. You guys had an Outer Limits thing on there. Yeah.
Hey, by the way, apologies.
Sure,
we were here.
Are you kidding me? It's the best part of the show so far.
Jesus. Yesterday we were here and we did not acknowledge Leon Tapp's passing.
That's right.
This happened over the weekend. He was a cut man, honestly, from UFC 1 through about, 5 years ago?
Maybe three years ago? Yeah.
And then he eventually retired, and we even saw him at the World MMA Awards, and he received recognition there for a contribution, you know, to the sport. But, you know, thoughts and prayers with the family. Stitch Duran, John McCarthy, they had gotten the word from the Tabs, Leon Tabs family, and so again, thoughts and prayers with their family. But what a life, huh? I mean, he did a lot in the boxing world and in the MMA world.
Yeah.
All right. Guys, well, thank you very much for stopping by. Very cool. John Morgan gave me a copy of this yesterday. It's called The Cross-Sectional Performance Analysis and Projection of the UFC Athlete.
And you said you've read the whole thing already?
No. I was clear about the fact. Well, I only got it yesterday, and I'm a terrible reader and terrible at reading comprehension. So two sweeps of it would be nice, but I started diving into it. It was pretty cool, man. These stats just jump out at you. Like, for example, the... Now the fights go about 2 minutes longer, you know, and the fact that bantamweights out knock out knockout. Their rate is higher than featherweights. Everything else is pretty much on par. So you guys have just done extensive studies. I mean, you guys have the cool facility, state-of-the-art UFCPI, but you felt like you needed to go further in your research, and now you've had about 18 months to accumulate data.
So, yeah, think about it. The sport of MMA, relatively new. What are you training for? How long does the average fight last? You know, you think about every other sporting event, there's a given time. You know, a soccer match is going to be, what, 90 minutes?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah.
Football, probably World
Give
Cup. You
I can confirm.
Plus the additional penalty time, yada, yada. That's 90 minutes. You know what you're in for. An MMA fight, sometimes it's like 7 minutes, booms. As a fan, you never know what you're in for either. So I'll let Duncan explain it, but he sort of reverse engineered the whole thing. You know, you look at how fights are won, at what times they're won, and then from there you figure out how to train.
Yeah, I mean, listen, this is the culmination of 12 months of operations at the Performance Institute, and we really wanted to get something out into the community to support, you know, the evolution of the sport of MMA. That's kind of our mantra and our mission over at the PI. We're not a fight team. We work with all the fighters, and what we do is we've got the great opportunity to work with all the fighters that come through the door. So it's a privileged position to be able to aggregate information as the guys are in our facility to do diagnostic testing and assessments in all of our respective areas, in the medical space, in the physical development space, from a nutrition perspective. So it's an amalgamation of all that information that we wanted to get out in the community and really start the conversation to say, hey, what is the best approach, as Forrest says, to, you know, optimize your performance and preparation for the world's toughest sport.
With all the information that you guys have been able to gather, is it different now when you watch fights? Do you almost watch it from a statistical standpoint, or do you still watch it watching the MMA fight and then go back and look at it?
So I got to confess, personally, I watch it trying to figure out what the judges are thinking.
Yeah.
Like, what? How's this going to go? You know? So
him and I kind of do that every time. We say, hey, this is what we think it is, but this is what we think the judges may be scoring.
And that's something we had, you know, we had actually a coaches forum Saturday, and we had about 50 of the best coaches from around the world come in. And one of their biggest complaints was something that I've often – there doesn't seem to be a stand-up rule that holds fast. Does that make sense? Like, I would like to be able to tell a fighter, hey – you have 12 seconds on the ground. If you don't throw an effective strike in 12 seconds, you're going to be stood up. Or if you stay on the wall, you fence somebody for more than 12 seconds without attempting a takedown and without, you know, creating some sort of scramble, they're going to stand you up.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, sometimes to me it depends if you're in venue on how loud the crowd cheers.
That's true.
But
yeah.
Everything else – Duncan has found a way to quantify and categorize.
Yeah, I mean, listen, this is just a start. As we see it, it's the first kind of savvy out there for us to get information out and disseminate amongst the community. And we're really going to be elevating this kind of interaction to support the coaches and athletes as we move forwards. But the question has already been answered by Forrest. What we're trying to understand is, what does it take to win? You know, now, there's technical and tactical aspects to that, of course, but there's huge amounts of physical aspects that we need to kind of truly understand. There's the resilience and injury prevention strategy, and then there's the energetics around the fight and how you manage that across a truly variable, you know, fight, as Forrest has talked to. So, you know, we've got some really cool data and some information that can now start shaping powerful considerations and conversations to say, how optimally can I set the practice up? How am I going to prepare for an up-and-coming opponent based on the matchmaking? Lots of considerations. But what we're trying to do is really give an understanding, what are the determinants of performance that affect success?
You know, George and I grew up as boxing fans, and throughout the years, all this information that you guys have put out on mixed martial arts, I don't remember hearing any of this stuff in the boxing world. Has the boxing community ever came to you guys and just kind of picked your brain?
12 months, right? We've only been up 12 months.
Yeah, not truly. I mean, we've – so here's the thing. If you think about MMA training, there's a lot of good boxing coaches that train MMA fighters. So to an extent, we've had, you know, we've had some relationship with them and told them some things that we'd found to be true.
I mean, boxing is one part of our sport, you know, and again, it's a huge consideration that we need to start drilling down into what are the respective aspects, you know, the stylistic components that go into our sport. Right now, what we've got the ability to present in 12 months is a pretty cross-sectional awareness of MMA, but we've now got to start looking at how stylistic influences come into influencing this data and changing the nature of fight. What's someone's trend in the preferred fight style and those types of things. So, I think what we can do is really support combat sport evolution, you know, holistically, not just in MMA. It's a real different approach that we're trying to take in the Performance Institute and applying, let's say, science to the approach and being truly intentional to support professional athletes. You know, there's money in the sport now, so people are trying to do it with the best strategy.
So to oversimplify and undervalue what he just said, I think about it like this. You think about the NFL Combine. Uh-huh. Every position on the field, we know the physical attributes, the anthropomorphic, that word.
Anthropometric.
Makeup that makes a successful player, right? We know that. In MMA, we don't know that. And then you talk about anthropomorphics.
That word.
Yep. You talk about arm length, you know, body type. How does that dictate the way you should fight? You know, how does your energy system, like what naturally, like I naturally have really good cardio for no apparent reason, but no explosion. How does that change the way I should train and then the way I should ultimately game plan and fight? We want to be able to offer insight to that as well.
Yeah,
for sure. In the future, not now. Not yet.
Well, I was going to joke, but half-heartedly serious when Goz asked about the boxing question. And I know it's just a movie, but I also was a fan of track and field growing up, and you always heard about the East Germans and the things they were doing with the body chemistry. But do you remember Rocky III? Remember they hooked up Dolph Lundgren? What was his name?
Rocky IV.
I've got the power.
What was the
too.
Russian's name?
Ivan Drago.
He's got things hooked up.
Rocky III was Clubber Lang. That was Clubber Lang.
Yeah, sorry about that.
They did the opposite with him. They went super old school.
Yeah. In that movie, you know, they had him, you know, hooked up as he's running treadmills and just doing everything. It seemed like they did take a scientific approach. Well, that was what, late 80s, that movie?
Something like that.
Right.
So that's the Performance Institute.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking was, I wonder if everyone's going to kind of be an Ivan Drago of sorts, you know, and you guys open the facility and athletes will try and obviously just become better athletes.
Ivan Drago is really giving testing a bad name. Right,
those Russians, man. No, I mean, listen. The Performance Institute's obviously got a huge amount of resource and technology capabilities, and listen, it's open to every fighter on the UFC roster to come through and utilize our services in the best way they see fit. But what we're truly aware of is that fighters are working out in a lot of different environments. You know, I was referred to Brian Ortega's got a world championship fight coming up here in the not too distant future, and his whole career is worked out of his garage. You know, so.
Small, actually. It's not like he has a big garage either.
Right. So we got to take pretty high-level scientific insights and moving forwards, try and understand how we can make it applicable to everybody on our roster. But everyone has the accessibility to come through the Performance Institute, interact with our world-class staff, and be around all our different departments, and get some of this information when they're here in Las Vegas.
Because fights do go an average of about 10 minutes and some change, it seems to me that the strength and conditioning coaches may even be one of the most important coaches to the fighters themselves in this era that we're moving to. Because when we've done this show for about 11 years now, so everybody would talk about improving their jiu-jitsu and their wrestling and this and that. But now, everybody that's coming through the sport, let's take Sean O'Malley, for example. They're good at everything because they're MMA fighters. They're not wrestlers or jiu-jitsu practitioners or boxers that came over and have to learn catch-up. They're learning it all. And now it just seems like I just need to be the best 100% Sean O'Malley, be healthy, learn how to recover from my workouts so that when I go out there, I can apply all these different tools that I've learned as a kid, but make sure that the one thing that never lacks is my wind.
I mean, as long as, again, as Duncan said, as long as you're training that intentionally and as long as that is supplemental to your actual MMA program. Here's the thing. If you've never developed any work capacity, you can't do 2 or 3 hours of training a day. So you have to have, at some point in your life, put in that, you know, that work.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. It's the whole program has got to be led by sport-specific conditioning. That's the MMA work is a priority. But I think what's important is that we now know how we can influence physical attributes through supplementary training, and how, you know, through strategically applying different stimuli, we can then transfer that across to the technical work that's going to be so crucial for the fighters. So,
and then back to the Drago, to me, one of the things that I wish I had had more of is testing. So I knew whether I was improving. Say it for me, if you're not...
Anthropometric.
No, if you're not assessing.
Oh, if you're not assessing, you're guessing?
So, which is something I never really I never really thought about this, but the whole time I'm like, I think I feel good. I feel better. I'm better than last camp, right? But are you? You know, has your training been effective? Are you improving physically? You know what? So the ability to monitor, that kind of allows you to know whether or not you're going in the right direction. Which is my preferred usage model for athletes to come into the PI. You know, come in every other month, get dialed in, go through all our services, have like an immersive 2 or 3 days, and then go home with a plan. And then come back a month or a month and a half later.
And compare.
Is that plan working? Okay. You know, have I gotten better? Am I able to complete my rounds? You know, and obviously you want to get the head coach's feed in and buy-in and say, hey, their feedback and buy-in. You know, hey, you look, you know what? You're able to hit harder in the later rounds, or you don't want to do mitts with you, you don't get as tired. Let's see, is there improvement? You know,
are the coaches receptive? I know a lot of fighters are starting to pour in now, and they have to have appointments. How about the coaches? Are they receptive to everything that you guys have to offer? Or are they more old school mentality?
I mean, it varies across
it runs the gambit.
Yeah, but this weekend it was fantastic. We were really excited of our first kind of opportunity to open the doors to the coaching community and speak to those guys about our thoughts, our insights, and what we've found here. But yeah, there was more questions and answers that came from the group, which was exciting for us because we really feel now we can support them in answering some of those questions moving forwards. That's kind of stage two, you know. Let's engage the community. Let's show our capabilities, and I think they're really excited by what we produced. But there's a lot more information.
How can we best serve their athletes, right? So, look, what is it that their athletes are lacking that they would like to know about their athlete that would help them, you know, adjust the way they train them? Mm-hmm.
I think that was a great idea to have the coaches come in, and hopefully they were receptive. Because in other sports, I always tend to tangent when we have these conversations. I think that's what changes the game. You guys have heard of Bill Parcells, who used to coach football. His thing was always run the ball. He wouldn't evolve, you know what I mean? And now if you look at the era they're in now, mm-hmm. everybody's just throwing. And certain coaches just get phased out. The great Bill Walsh from the NFL said, you can only do 10 years, and then after that, we're all conditioned in what worked, but the game changes. So I imagine the same thing's going to apply to the sport.
Yeah, we hope so. I always use the analogy of the NHL. You know, there used to be a big enforcer that would sit in the middle of the ice that would fight, and you know, they would basically run the game. But now someone figured out if we get a group of small guys that can speedy around the ice and skate around that guy, we're going to win the game. So the game has now changed. It's the NHL is a speed game rather than a collision and contact game. So
I don't want to necessarily believe the coach about, you know, the 10 years. I think some coaches, as I saw this weekend, have a growth mindset. You know, you can't be afraid of new things. There's always going to be new things. Now, don't be afraid of them, but it's okay to be skeptical of them because, trust me, we've heard a lot of – I've seen a lot of strength conditioning coaches, nutritionists, dietitians, what have you, that were, you know, they were just kind of they were just wrong
in
a lot of instances. So, yeah. Be open-minded but skeptical. That's
I'm sure they can stand
coaches.
The test of time. Yeah. That was just a football comparison. But if you'll recall, remember when everyone used to wear the every gym had an elevation room. Some guys were flipping tires. Some were doing the axe. Some were doing the mask.
Training.
Shark Tank. I remember Extreme Couture years ago. Shark Tank. You know, I don't see as much as that when I go to Extreme Couture. So a lot of those things just kind of get phased out. You still see that tire maybe off to the side, but no one's ever using it. So – the sport also changes.
I tell you what, I was really good at faux construction. If they had, like, you know, where you just beat a tire and flip and carry stuff and do, like, fake yard work, I'd be so good at that. Which is weird because I'm not actually good at real yard work. But
you carried all them cases on season one,
remember
that?
Faux construction. I was really, because it was fake. Yeah, nothing actually got done. So good at that.
That's CrossFit.
So let me ask CrossFit. You guys this. When you guys had...
I should have done CrossFit. That's what I was built for.
When you guys did the UFC PI, I remember when you guys were doing tours for the media that you stated that other sports were very influential because you guys weren't a competitor. It's a whole different sport.
Right. So they were able to... they let us look under the hood, or under the skirt, if you will.
Right. And when it came down to preparing these journal and running these data points and statistics, same thing. Was it just you guys that gathered this, or were other sports able to assist in that as well?
I mean, this has been very much our staff at the Performance Institute have formulated what's going to be most effective for a fighter, you know, because not every sport needs the same diagnostics.
So what I will say is all of our coaches and staff come from different backgrounds. They've all experienced other sports. And that was something that was important to us when we were looking for staff, is that they weren't, you know, again, that they were kind of more open-minded and well-rounded. So they had those backgrounds. They'd already been around, you know, multiple other sports.
Mm-hmm. What I will say off the back of this being released here in the last couple of days as well is I've already been contacted by other international Olympic sports from different countries around the world, including the U.S., looking at comparative data to say, you know, what's the power output of your fighter compared to our track and field guys or whatever it may be. So now we're really starting to elevate the conversation of putting MMA in a conversation with Olympic sports and really interrogating performance standards and saying, well, you know, we're going to get to a point where we can say an MMA fighter is X ranked against all these respective sports from rugby and soccer and football and basketball and you name it. So that's going to be really cool when we can do that effectively.
What did Dana think of the journal?
He was excited, yeah. We met with him yesterday and talked him through it, and he's known about this process all along, and super stoked. Really, really excited about it, you know, its reach and what it can potentially do for the sport in the UFC.
Did anything stand out for him as far as, like, can you believe, you know, like, any of the stats? Or
no, I think he's still digesting it.
Yeah.
Okay.
You know, it's kind of a lot going on in here. Like I said, I read it three times, and I almost understand all of it.
How about the heavyweights? Now, obviously, I'm looking at this stat, average fight time.
Yeah.
The one thing when we've interviewed fighters is the heavyweights, the one thing they always just kind of fall back on is it can end
power
with one strike or the big dudes. And they play it off like some other stuff is just not for them. Have they, over the years, not just to this journal, which obviously is only a few days old, but the performance PI, excuse me, the UFC PI, have they been receptive to everything you guys have to offer compared to the other divisions?
That's a great question. I mean, I think what we try and do is this is a cross-sectional awareness of the whole sport and of you know respective weight classes, but we direct all of our programming based on the individual. So, again, that way we can be super intentional, and that's why as Forrest talks about objectivity and diagnostics, it now means that no two heavyweights are alike. We can take the trend for the heavyweight division or for any weight division and see what kind of the general trend is for that division, but now we've got to take you as an individual who might be 6 foot 5 or 7 foot if you're Struve through to you know someone who's 6 foot and just heavier or wider, let's say. So lots of different body types, lots of different styles. We're now going to be able to say how you essentially your physiology, your physical attributes can best accommodate or meet the demands of that weight class. So that's how we like to program on a very individual level for sure.
That's kind of what I want to segue into a little bit. And Forrest, you can help me out a little bit here. In the early days, say, of Extreme Couture, going up to veterans like a Mike Pyle, a Jay Haran, Randy Couture, you'd often see fighters kind of pick their brain. What works for you? You would try that out, and maybe it worked for you, maybe it didn't. But that was what worked
for
them.
Those guys cornered me, too.
Yeah.
Helped me with game plans, et cetera. Yeah.
So what's happening here now is you guys get to go in, and you get to find out from you guys what works for the individual, for them right away. So what is that process like? Can you share what it was like the first time you found out all this stuff? And then what it's like for the average fighter when they come in to say, I've got my results, and now I'm implementing them. How long is that process for them to say, okay, this is something that works?
Well, so here's what we want. Here's what I want anyway. Duncan probably wants something totally different. No, I'm kidding. So I want an athlete to come in and tell me what they're looking to improve, how they want to fight, what they want to. I want to be able to fight for 25 minutes. I want to fight like Kane or Stipe. Talk about heavyweights that go the distance. You know, I want to be able to fight like that, right? Versus, you know, what is it? What's your game plan and what physical attributes can you tell me that you need for your game plan? A guy like Neil Magny, you know, I'm looking to improve my one punch power and my one punch output, but at the end of the day, I'm going to grind people. So I need to develop both of these systems. So I want you to tell me, you know, what physical attributes you think you need for your game plan.
That's amazing.
like, you know, Colby Covington, obviously, you got a tremendous amount of cardio. Mm-hmm. You know, so, man, I'm guessing that's what he works a lot of his time on, spends a lot of his time working.
Yeah, I mean, athletes, you know, we're human beings, right? We default to what we like doing and what we're good at.
And not just, yeah, what we're good at and what we think we're better than an opponent at. If we have a matchup, where do I want this fight to be? What, you know, physiological attributes do I need to maximize that part of the fight?
You know what I really like is when fighters who haven't really been athletic, but they just had that fighting gene, whether it was the streets or whatever, become athletic. A lot of people feel like this guy is more athletic than I am. I can never close the gap, and that's not true. I've seen it happen. Like we were talking about RDA earlier and Colby. RDA was a jiu-jitsu practitioner, and now that dude, I mean, he can hit pretty hard, and he can sustain that power even in the later rounds, you know? And I hope a lot of fighters realize that, and I think the PI is a place that can open their eyes to stuff like that.
I hope so.
They have higher limits than what they think they do. At least some of the younger fighters I run into, they just feel like, you know, they can't match the speed. But I think you can improve on all that.
RDA's got a good strength coach, and he works a lot on staying healthy and, you know, building up so he can take the power of training. But, yeah, he's a guy. He's not necessarily a one-punch guy, but he's a cumulative knockout guy now, even at 170. And you think about it, he got knocked out at 55 by a 45-year-old. What's
Stevens.
His name? Yeah, Jeremy Stevens, who now fights at 45, and he fights at 70. So, yeah, I mean, you can you have your genetics, but as they say, they're influenceable. You know, you can't change your genetics, but you can influence them to an extent.
And what we always talk about over the PI is, you know, in a sport like MMA, we want to make your strength super strength. You know, it's still a sport where if you have if you're polarizing a particular skill set, be it, you know, jiu-jitsu or a great striker or a big engine, you know, you got to maximize that potential. That's your X factor. But it's the decathlon of MMA, and therefore we've got to drive your development by taking your limitations and raising your limitations, you know. So by being intentional through diagnostics or, you know, as conversations with coaches and goals and objectives, we can now target what your limitations are and raise the low-hanging fruit, and essentially there you're taking the whole thing up, you know. So
your roster size is about 550, right?
Yeah.
568.
What percentage uses the UFC PI?
Well, we've had over 300 athletes of that roster. We've had over 300 athletes through in the first 12 months, which we're really excited about. And the retention rate, so guys that come through and either use us again remotely, because we do a lot of remote work, or are revisiting the Performance Institute, is right around 67%. So that's a number we're really excited about. So, you know, we're well over halfway through the roster of guys visiting the PI and experiencing it and having an immersive experience. And guys are re-engaging, which we're really excited about.
The guys and gals that haven't used it, is it more of a distance thing?
Yeah, I mean, geography is always going to be our biggest challenge.
They may not believe it. Again, maybe they're just older and set in their ways. Or what would you say is the reasoning for why the others haven't used it?
I mean, you take your thoughts on it, but...
Yeah, the first one, the easiest, geography. The second, and I think we've overcome this to an extent, the fact is we're in the same building as the matchmakers and everybody else. And, you know, let's say I was a fighter, hypothetically, I would be a little bit, you know, concerned that what I did there would you know, seep into the rest of the building. So this is the time where I take to assure everyone that that absolutely does not happen. In fact, I don't see any of the results because I'm, like myself and a guy named James Kimball, we're kind of the connection to the rest of the UFC, and we don't know any fighters' data at all. Does that make sense? So your data is your own, and it will never, you know, be used against you in any way. That's the important thing. You know, you've got an injury before a fight. You want to come in and have a physical therapist look at it. You don't want anybody to know that. So I think that's a little bit of the fear initially. But, I mean, as we've had successful cases, and, you know, people are overcoming that to an extent.
And on that point, I would, again, give kudos to the guys back on the ground over the PI. You know, we can legitimately talk about 18 fights that were potentially going to be removed. The fighters have come and worked with our medical staff, and those guys have kept the fights on. So we're seeing truly impactful benefits on fight cards, and that's the whole point of the Performance Institute.
You're listening to MMA Junkie Radio on SiriusXM Rush 93. We're going to take a break. Stay close. We'll be right back. We have Duncan French and Forrest Griffin from the UFC PI here in studio. Still got half an hour left, so we'll be right back. Stay close. Don't touch the dial.
daughter loves this song. Turn it up.
I get paid to say things in this cool voice, and they get paid to be lame. Here are Gorgeous George and Goes.
SiriusXM's World Cup coverage continues tomorrow with a tripleheader from Russia. First, Cristiano Ronaldo and Portugal meet Morocco. Then, Uruguay scores off with Saudi Arabia, followed by Iran versus Spain. Here, live match coverage beginning tomorrow at 8 in the morning Eastern Time on Fox Sports on SiriusXM Channel 93. Then, tune over to SiriusXM FC 157 immediately after each match for instant reaction from our experts. All right, we have Duncan French and Forrest Griffin from the UFC PI here. John Morgan now joins us on the panel.
That's Performance Institute to you.
I do, yeah.
Hey guys, I'm excited, man. I got a chance to read this journal a little bit, and I'm kind of like you, Forrest. First reading was a little bit overwhelming. Yeah, I had to go back. I mean, it's a lot of numbers and stuff, but I did want to ask you. I mean, it's
well, I'll tell you what you need to do. If you just had your office right next to Duncan's,
that would help out.
Literally just walk over as you're reading it and stop whatever important shit he's doing and bug him.
I got nothing done. I got nothing done.
You would understand it. Like, so now I feel like pretty comfortable.
Well, I want to know, I mean, as individualized as you guys are, I mean, because obviously this is tailored to every athlete, right. But the one thing that stood out to me was I loved the scheduling kind of concept you had in there that seemed to show how to peak an athlete, how to taper off right before the fight. And I wondered, that kind of got me thinking, as specific as this is, was there any general concept, and maybe it was the scheduling concept, but was there anything in your research so far that applied to essentially everyone where you're like, Jesus, if everybody in our roster would just recognize this principle right here, it would make huge improvements to our sport?
Yeah, I mean, you make touch on a great point, John. I think, you know, the guys on the strength and conditioning floor, Bo Sandoval is our director of strength and conditioning over there. He gets to interact with a lot of the fight teams and the fight camps, as does Clint Wattenberg, our director of nutrition. So just collecting some of the information about how fighters and coaches and camps are going about preparing for the fight. What we're seeing is there's lots of different ways. Now, some of it makes sense, and some of it you could potentially say, you know, that's kind of not the best approach from a physiological perspective. And you remember what our capabilities are not to truly influence the technical tactical preparation. Of course, that drives the direction of the conversation. But what we can do is really complement the conversation around, hey, this is the way your body responds to a stress. You've got an energetic cost about this kind of grappling workout. Does it make sense to do that at this time of the day, this many times a week? You know, how many times are we sparring? What's the cost of that sparring? How are you recovering? All these different kind of considerations. So we've kind of collected and brought that together. Now what you'll see is that we've got heavy data chapters, and then there's some philosophical chapters. And I think that was purposefully done. We want to kind of say, here's the position stand, let's say, from the Performance Institute. And some of that is definitely a philosophical approach to the best way to go about it. Yeah.
So I did actually, at the forum we had just the other day, to me, I said, you know, this is what I think is the most important takeaway, is that it's just that you need a structure. You know, like, I think I'm going to do this. You need a structure and a plan. And so you lay a plan out, and then you actually do it, and you kind of record what you do. And unlike what I never did, you should probably look back at that before your next camp.
Decide if it worked or not.
Yeah. So I always had a plan, and then I wrote what I actually did, but I never reviewed it in any fashion. So the idea is that you can use your body or, you know, the information in this journal just to determine your volume and frequency.
I think the cool thing about, I mean, this journal by itself, just the thing is well produced. Like, it's amazing. But I noticed you guys put it online too. So, I mean, this is not like hidden information. I mean, the whole thing is on there, not only for, I guess, UFC athletes, but for any athlete or anybody that's interested. I mean, it's right there.
Team worked their asses off on this. They get it out there. They're proud of
for
it.
Sure. No, I mean, listen, we want to, you know, position the UFC as a conversation, you know, part of the conversation in global human performance. You know, we obviously want to support the guys in the MMA community, and that's always going to be our number one. But this is, we think this is cool stuff, and we think it's definitely got value, conversational value, with other sports and other athletes from around the world. So, yeah, we're proud of it, like Forrest says, but at the same time, we want to have the conversation. We want to understand how we can help our athletes optimize their performance, prepare better, be more resilient, minimize injuries, you know, get their dietary requirements right, and essentially elevate the whole sport.
You said 300, more than 300 on the roster. I've been here. I know that since I first saw a facility, I've been one of the guys saying everybody should be here. I don't see why you wouldn't take advantage of it. But I do wonder, it seems like, you know, obviously the fighters that live here, they're there all the time. Sometimes it seems like fighters swing in for a couple of days and check it out. It seems like people have been staying about a week. I mean, if somebody's on the fence or not sure, I mean, what's ideal for an athlete to come check this out to actually get the benefits of everything you have to offer there? Is it a week? Is it a month? Is it a fight camp? What do you recommend?
Well, so what I can say is what I would do. If I didn't live in Las Vegas, I wasn't training here, if I lived somewhere else, I would fly out for, you know, 2 or 3 days every other month. And like I said, just get like a plan and just kind of, this is what I've done, this is where I'm at. So, you know.
Fight camp, non-fight camp, all year long.
Yeah.
You know, monitoring. What do I look, what does my body look like when it's in fight camp, composition-wise? What does it look like when I'm at a fight camp? What is my, you know, how many calories do I burn? What's my basal metabolism in camp, out of camp? You know, how can I influence that? So, you know, again, did he say the assessing you're guessing? If you're not assessing, you're guessing. I know he said it's just very true.
It makes sense.
Know? And if you think about a sport like MMA, a lot of it's by feel. You know, your coach Holden Mitzvah says you feel good. Your training partner says, man, you're strong today. Maybe you're strong today, or maybe he's just – that's not an objective measurement. That's subjective. Maybe he's just having a bad day. Maybe he was up late last night, yada, yada, right?
I mean, the only thing I would add to that is, you know, the off-camp phase is crucial. You know, we have a fight camp mentality in MMA, you know, let's say 6 to 10 week fight camps. But by doing diagnostics and assessments off-camp, when we're doing small phases of development, small periods of trying to influence a specific physical or physiological attribute, you can still find great value in understanding if that's gone up or it's regressed or whatever might happen. So, yeah, we believe year-round, and, you know, towards the end of the document, you'll see our big paradigm that we've put together of you know, integrated roadmap of the best way to prepare for MMA. But that there's a huge consideration around off-camp work as well as just in-camp, you know?
Two things to that point. Off-camp, so outside of the 8 weeks to 10 weeks before camp, that's when you're doing new skill development and acquisition, right? That's 8 weeks in, you're just sharpening the sword, right? You're just working on specifically. It becomes more tactical than technical. You can't get strong in 8 weeks while you're dieting. So if you want to get strong, if you want to gain some sort of dynamic, explosive strength, you have to do that out of camp. So, you know, it just what's the best-selling book you're going to write?
The 52-week fight camp.
Yeah. So the thing is, here's the thing, man. You're in the UFC. You're a professional. You take 1 week after your fight, but you should be doing something. You're a professional athlete. Train like a professional athlete.
Forrest, I want to ask you something because you have a unique perspective on this. I mean, Duncan, obviously, you bring a lot to the table. Forrest, as a former world champion, a former fighter, so what's the biggest overall opportunity or goal, I guess, for fighters? I mean, is this about elongating careers? Is it about making sure that little window you have is maximized?
That is in our mission statement. To elongate, it's about performing your best, so, you know, optimizing performance. Not to drop too many buzzwords on you, but so, you know, fighting at your best as long as possible. So think about it. The way I look at it is, you take a guy like Cody Garbrandt. He was big time, right? He was so hyped. He had a back injury. It's been going on, going from what I hear. And I'm just hearing this through media. But he had a back injury, never really took care of it. And what happened? He missed almost a year, right? And he wasn't quite the same. And so the UFC as a company put all this money into him. I felt like he was on the verge of really changing that 135
superstardom.
Right. And he didn't fight for a year, and people forgot, nobody cared.
Right.
So he lost a big opportunity there, right? Just through, you know, not taking care of things day to day, week to week, you let injuries pile up, you don't get things, you know, looked at properly, whatever. And I don't know specifically what happened to him, but I'll use another case, and unfortunately we had nothing to do with this, but it'd be awesome if we did. A guy like Michael Bisping, I thought he was done, but he came back. You know, I thought he was done when he lost to Tim Kennedy.
Right.
He got out scrambled. He'd never been out scrambled in a fight before. He got out scrambled, outworked in that fight. You know, he I was you could see it at one eye. He comes back, becomes champion, defends the belt, you know, beats Anderson Silva in a huge fight in London. And so think about all the money he made at the back of his career. When he was already popular, already had a big name, that's when you're, you know, unfairly, because the world sucks, when your body starts to break down.
That's when your earnings potential is at its max.
That's when your reputation, your earning potential is at its highest. That's when people want to pay to see you fight, just as, you know, physiologically you're starting to break down. So the longer you can keep going here, and the, you know, we talk about, you know, cognitive decline, or just decline, performance decline, the longer you can keep it here as opposed to here, the higher the angle there, you can, you know, make a lot more money.
If the UFC PI was around when you were fighting, how many more fights do you think you would have had?
I don't know.
Or maybe more years.
So I think Heather RPT would have probably – I would have had at least one more. So I blew my knee out. That's just a training accident. You're going to blow your knee out if you're wrestling hard. I don't know that, you know, hey, it's still fighting, right? There's still going to be injuries. But had I had someone like Heather, I believe I could have come back from that and at least fought one or two more times, you know.
We've talked about performance. Let's talk about injury. You guys broke down the percentage of, you know, when it happens between a fight and training, and obviously those are like the highest of the two. So what have you guys been able to figure out as far as like injury? What are you guys telling the athletes and coaches? Is there something that they just need to do a little bit less of? You can never like say don't wrestle or don't do jiu-jitsu or do whatever, you know, the things that where there's a lot of common injuries, but is there something that they just need to taper down?
Yeah, I mean, the stat that probably sticks out most is that, you know, chronic overuse injuries take 50 days out of your training. You know, they are truly preventable injuries. 50 days returning to your training is massive for a professional athlete. So, you know, that's simply by managing load and looking at practice distribution across time. We can really support the community and understand how can we do that. You know, we don't want to lose 50 days of an athlete unnecessarily. Like you say, injuries in our sport are inevitable. They're going to happen. How can we minimize that? How can we make fighters more robust by doing corrective exercises? And some of these chronic injuries that exacerbate across time might not necessarily be fighting related or training related, but just by the postures and positions that fighting puts you in chronically, since you've been, you know, wrestling since 12 years old in this forward position, you know, that's just going to catch up with you. And biomechanically, it's not a great position to be in. So
one thing I didn't see that I'm wondering about, how involved are you guys getting in weight cutting research? How involved are you guys?
Well, hold on. I have a great answer to that last question first. We'll get there.
Okay.
That's a whole other can of worms. But here, so the information in this, you want to reduce injuries, change the way you do your practices. Think about a practice. A lot of times you'll kind of roll for an hour or start up or, you know, work for an hour and then go hard, right? Do you warm up for a fight like that? Is that how a fight's set up? Think about how many, you know, severe injuries that cost you a lot of time and potentially a surgery occur at the end of practice, the last round, etc. What's happened there is your nervous system, first of all, your glycogen's done. Your fuel source is done. You've used all your fuel up in that first hour. Second, your nervous system is at a point where you're so taxed. One, you're training bad form, bad technique, right? And two, you can't defend yourself. You know, when you see a fighter get tired in a fight, what happens? They straighten up. They go to this, either they hunch or they straighten up. Either way, they get in a bad position, bad posture. When you, as a coach, see your athlete getting in that bad posture, maybe pull them back from live sparring and just do more situational goes. So that's one thing I think you can use, is situational goes. The other, how many people do you have in a mat and a cage at one time? You
remember
too many, the
first season of The Ultimate Fighter, Nate Quarry, who I could have won that 185-pound thing, you know, the show, had his leg blown out because he was working too many people in a cage.
Rashad Evans, same thing.
That was Rashad too, yeah. So that's kind of our model, is more that you have your one or two, three UFC athletes, and that you have that controlled go. So my philosophy on training is that you start in the cattle roll. Right, so you start with a group of 20 or 30, 40, and then as you rise to that, okay, I'm in the UFC, I'm making a paycheck now, I'm doing well, I've won a couple fights in the UFC, then you pull your camp out. And this is what Randy Couture did. He pulled his camp out, and he took his two or three people that he needed for that fight. Now, off-season, he would still do the rolls and the cattle classes, but 8 to 10 weeks out from a fight, he pulled the people specifically that he wanted the resistance against for that fight and did his own thing. Now, that costs a little more money. And that's something I did. I actually flew wrestlers in and I put them up at my house. So, you know, they would. I got a lot of wrestlers, good, like college wrestlers, that would do it for free. So I would just fly them out, put them up in my house, and just, you know, make them go to practice with me. And they would benefit by doing the striking stuff, and I would benefit by using them as wrestling partners. So just, again, kind of that's the way you need to, you know, structure camps to reduce injuries.
Got to take our second break. You're listening to MMA Junkie Radio on
Sirius. The other thing would be monitoring your recovery.
Rush 93, stay close. We'll be right back. We have Duncan French and Forrest Griffin in studio.
Especially goes. Here, Gorgeous George and goes.
If you play fantasy sports, SiriusXM has the channel just for you. Listen to Fantasy Sports Radio to hear expert advice from the top fantasy baseball and fantasy football analysts. Whether you need to help setting up your baseball lineup or you want to know who the breakout players will be in fantasy football this season, the place to be is Sirius 210 XM87 and streaming on your phone or at home on SiriusXM connected devices and speakers. Let's take a couple quick calls. Dan Tom joining us now on the panel. Brandon from Louisville, you got to make it quick, buddy. What's up?
Okay, I'll make it quick then. Just real quick, a question for the Forrest and Duncan, the PI, future goal, not this year, not next year, down the road, expansion, East Coast, Europe, Asia, Brazil, make it more available to more fighters?
Yeah, I mean, we do have, so we want to make sure we get all our ducks in a row and kind of create the hub in Las Vegas first, but yeah, there will be other PIs in the future.
Okay, let's go to Cordrick in Arizona. What's up, Cordrick?
Good, Gorgeous George and Forrest Griffin, big time fan. Watched the first Ultimate Fighter because of you. You're the man. I just want to say you're the man and everything. And just want to talk about the whole weight cutting issue real quick. Just about how.
Sure.
I was listening to yesterday's show and just like how you guys are talking about you have to be real professional about everything. I wonder, is there something with the UFC, like how Yoel, Mackenzie Dern, and like how these
fighters are missing weight, is there like a protocol that they go through of like weight cutting? Like, is there disciplinary actions or like, well, what's the deal to where it can minimize all this weight cutting thing?
So thank you, Cordrick.
So first, let's look at the structure. These are independent contractors that work with the UFC. So they are punished by the athletic commissions. They're fined, potentially suspended. There are commissions that will require them to get medical clearance from a doctor to say they can make that weight. For us at the PI, we're really about, you know, proper fueling, proper nutrition, and just walking around reasonably close to that weight. You know, we preach 10%. My thought, what I tell perfect fighters number. Is why are you walking around heavier than you fight on Octagon Day? So this is something I did the first 3 or 4 years of my career. I found out that I could walk around at 235 and I could still make 205, which is real cool if you like to eat a lot, and I do. But I couldn't get heavier than 222, 223 on fight day. So the last week or two before the fight, I actually felt weak. I felt I was physically weaker in the octagon than I was in the 8 weeks preparing for it. Because I had like a 14-day system dialed in, and I could get from 230 to 205, no problem. But I could never rebound as much as I wanted, and I felt like I was a little depleted going into those fights. So, I mean, I changed my way of life. I actually changed a little bit of my strength conditioning, obviously my diet a little bit. I lost some of that muscle. And I felt better, and I performed better after I walked around at 225, which is, you know, relatively close to what I could get to on fight day. So what I would tell you to do is see what you're actually going to be able to compete at, first of all, comfortably. Because I was 227 once, and I felt like I had a cannonball in my stomach. So, I mean, that's the biggest piece of advice. The other piece is you've got to fuel yourself pre, post. You know, are you having 3 weeks of garbage workouts leading up to the most important, you know, event in your career because you are on a crash diet that you forced yourself into a bad situation to do?
I love the 10% rule. We were actually saying that the other day. All right, Duncan, I'm not sure if you wanted to also chime in on this, but we're up against the top of the hour. You guys stated that you have a little bit of additional time.
That's fine.
So we were able to do some adjusting on our scheduling here. So the guys will stay a few minutes here.
As long as you throw in another commercial, Sirius will be happy.
You got it. We're going to do that, and then I'll let Dan ask some questions. John, if you had any follow-ups, we'll do that. We're talking about the cross-sectional performance analysis and projection of the UFC athlete. This journal, 80 pages long, with 30,000 data points and stats, was released the last couple days, and it's very, very informative. All the fighters and coaches have it at their disposal. And, hey, the game is changing for the better, right?
100%. And may I plant a seed before we go to break while we're on the topic of weight cutting? 15-second seed. People talk about USADA possibly going around with scales to help track weight. Has there been any kind of any push from the PI to track fighters or any fighters volunteering to have you guys track their weights in regard to the weight cutting
I'll let the
research?
Guys answer when we come back. We're up against the clock. It's MMA Junkie Radio on SiriusXM, Rush 93, Duncan French, and Forrest Griffin here in studio with us, both of them from the UFC PI. Yes, that's the guy from the Ultimate Fighter Season 1. That's the guy that won the world title at the light heavyweight division. That's also the guy who was very generous with his walk-around weight stories. I heard 240, sometimes 250, but anyway. All right, we'll be right back.
Never, never 250. Never be the same.
It's hard to flick it that way, but it's easier to flick it that way.
All right, here we go. It's the second hour of the MMA Junkie Radio Show. The guys have allowed us to keep them here for an extra 15 minutes or so. We have Dan Tom here as part of our panel, and we wanted to follow up on something Cordrick started that John had introduced and that Dan, I think, was going to also touch on, is the weight cutting question.
Is it glycolic conditioning for B, 200 points? No.
The weight cutting, you threw out the number of 10%. I really, really like that. And Dan, go ahead and ask your question, but then I want to follow up on that.
The weight in regards to the weight cutting.
The one that you asked.
Oh, yeah, it was just essentially a lot of fan talk as far as weight cutting goes. Some people are saying USADA should be, you know, marking weights and tracking weights as far as gaining information. And obviously, you guys have been gaining a lot of information. Has any of that information been toward weights? And is that on your guys' end, or is that something maybe the fighters have gone to you guys as far as volunteering themselves? Anything on the weight cutting front?
Yeah. So of course, we're doing a lot with weight management, weight cutting, weight descent for competition, whatever you want to call it. So you were kind of talking almost a little bit about enforcement earlier, like going around with scales. And anything we do is just the athlete asks us for help. We want to engage with them. We're here as a resource, but we're not here to report to anyone. Our whole model of business doesn't work if we are, you know, some weird, kind of Gestapo like arm of the UFC. We're just the opposite of that. So if an athlete comes to us, say, hey, I'm having a problem losing some potential body fat or whatever, that's confidential information. You know, that's medically sensitive information. That's HIPAA compliant. I don't really want to know the conversations or the metabolic tests that occur in our facility. I just want athletes to know that they're available and that you can get these results. And, you know, we'd be happy to engage with any athlete and help them change. But we're not going to ever get into the business of monitoring and reporting back. Or, you know, if the commission wants to do that, if Andy Foster in California wants to do that, hey, I think that's great for them. But we have no designs or intentions of doing anything like that.
Do you agree with 10%? Is that a good number as well?
Yeah,
in your mind, as far as what an athlete should walk around and drop 10% of their weight and that be their weight class.
Remember, so it's less than 10.
Yeah.
So you don't have to do 10 if you're not comfortable.
Mm-hmm. Clint Wattenberg is our director of nutrition over there. He's heavily involved in trying to understand, you know, what does physiology do? What's the best rehydration strategies and what does that look like, you know, from refueling and rehydration? So, yeah, we have data. We have historical data from checking weights and, you know, on fight week and then obviously official weigh-ins and rebound weights that we interrogating and looking at and trying to understand what's actually happening. So that's where the kind of 10% or less than it has come from, and that's definitely driven by Clint as our lead in that space. So
yeah, because a 55er under the 10% rule would be 172. I like that. Mm-hmm. When I hear of guys coming down from 190, 195, I mean, it's like that's not even like a twofold, threefold. It's like a tenfold answer because, for one, mm-hmm. it's better business for the UFC. You know what I mean? For these guys to be healthier for longer periods of time, better performance.
Well.
Yes.
Fight parity is huge.
The whole point of weight classes is that you are reasonably close to the person you're fighting on fight night. So if you think about all these, what athletes and their kind of secondary people have helped them do is they're trying to game the system. So if you're trying to game the system, be as big as you possibly can on fight night, and then you don't make it, I don't really feel bad for you. You know, you knew what you were trying to do.
Okay. All right. Dan, do you have any more questions?
Another hot topic along with weight cutting.
That last piece was just personal, not PI related.
All right,
that was
gotcha.
My personal opinion.
I don't know if you know, but Forrest has got a strong opinion, right?
It's all good. Well, this one's more about another one people have strong opinions about, just, you know, head trauma. It's obviously right. A science that the problem is it's a part of our sport, but it's also not a developed science. We're still learning. And you guys said that there's, you know, from other athletic fields are reaching out to you guys about your information that you guys collect.
Right.
Has there been any type of reach out as far as, you know, the neurological or the brain health side of things saying, hey, you know, is there any, you know, whether it's vestibular therapies or any basic kind of things that you know, people are reaching out to you guys, or again, are fighters, you know, coming out and saying, hey, do you guys offer anything as far as testing for concussion protocols or anything like that?
Yeah.
I brought you the right guy.
I mean, yeah, we're trying to be super proactive in that space. Again, we're not trying to hide from the fact. We're trying to address it so that we can put the fighters in the healthiest position possible, you know. We're heavily engaged, you know, from a research perspective with the Cleveland Clinic here in town. So, you know, we're the biggest contributors to research, 5-year research study that's just been renewed, where any UFC fighter can go and get free MRI scans, and those fighters that are moving into retirement as well. So that's given us hard biological science to say, you know, what is the implications of fighting and what does it do to the fighter's health. But we're also looking at, you know, our return to play strategies, how we can influence fighters post-fight. So if someone gets knocked out during a fight, you know, they're going to go to the hospital, they're going to get imagery, but if there's no immediate imagery showing, you know, a problem, it doesn't mean there's no concussion, but now we've got to try and advise and give them guidance on what are appropriate return to play strategies, from increasing cardiovascular demand, when do you return to full practice, etc., etc. So that's where we feel the PI can really contribute to that process as well, and we'll be pushing that type of content out to the community moving forward as well on some of our social platforms and our networks. So yeah, brain health. You know, we're looking at equipment redevelopment and trying to be, you know, innovative, talking to football helmet manufacturers and how they've tried to influence it. So we're capturing ideas from other third parties as well to try and really support, you know, the UFC and MMA fighters.
Well, sure. I definitely appreciate that attitude, kind of like, again, what Forrest said about your guys' more open attitude. We're not trying to, you know, air out dirty laundry. It's not going to affect your careers. We're trying to help, you know, the overall scene of things. And again, I think Forrest used the example of Cody Garbrandt. He's another great example where he had concussion problems early on, and look, he ended up becoming a UFC champion later on in his career. So that's awesome to hear.
Yeah, we appreciate it.
You know, when you guys mention BMI and blood work and everything that a fighter can do to test their conditioning and also the nutrition, where does it start? What is the most important factor that where you start breaking down a fighter? Chemistry.
It starts at the destination. That's what I always say.
Where you want to get to.
Goals.
Exactly.
What are your goals?
If you don't know what the fight is, how you succeed in your weight class, if we haven't got true clarity on what is the fight and how do you win in that particular fight, how do you then engineer a direction to get there if you don't know where you're going? Mm-hmm. That's kind of the whole philosophy behind this booklet. You know, the first chapter was how do you win in the fight? Now we can drop everything in behind that to accurately guide the way to that.
Wow,
the promised land.
I mean, hey, I'm a volume guy. I like to wear my guy down and break him, and then in the third round take him out. Versus the guys that just want to steamroll somebody in the first round, get things done.
Right.
That's when you start to come up with your
exactly.
their plan, and how to distribute their energy at the appropriate time.
Yeah, and remember, we're a promotion, right? So matchmaking is a huge part of our sport, and that changes. So, you know, you've got to plan and accordingly for your opponent. That's going to shape your preparation, obviously. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm not teaching people to suck eggs, but you've got to start with the end point and then work everything back from there. And then we're starting to talk about how long does it take to change someone's physiology? If I want to increase my engine because I'm fighting Forrest and I know this guy's got a diesel and he's going to be going for 5 rounds easy, well, you know, I might be a heavy, you know, heavy hitter, and I might be an explosive guy. That's going to take a period of time to make that adaptation. It's not going to happen in an 8-week fight camp, I can tell you right now. All right, so some of these things we've got to really start considering the duration of time and the strategy that it takes to get there.
Who's maximized the PI more, women or men?
I think we're pretty balanced, right?
Yeah, so 16.9% of the UFC roster is female. We're at about 23% female, 22%.
Yeah.
So they slightly over-index.
Females would strike me more as being detail-oriented and maybe following up on everything you've...
Absolutely. Yeah,
well,
absolutely.
You're obviously sexist and stereotyped.
Got him.
One last question each. What's the most fulfilling part of your job?
I mean, I think this type of thing, working with a great team of people that want to change the sport. You know, we've got a true world-class team over at the UFC Performance Institute. We're very proud of what we're doing. I'm very proud of all the work that they're doing. But we're all in it because we ultimately came with a blank page to try and shape the sport of MMA and to help the fighters out there. So that's kind of, you know, the true mantra of what we're doing.
I assume you mean other than doing this interview. been right. the most.
Can you still dunk a basketball?
I cannot.
No.
I cannot still. You believe
he
that?
He can't
crap?
Get his arm over his head. For oh,
you're not 40 yet, right?
I'm 41. 41? Yeah, I'm 40, okay. 40. I'm old, yeah.
All right.
Yeah, and it's the knee surgery, though. The knee surgery. That
but that wasn't really my last question. My last question is, what's the most fulfilling part of your job, kind of athlete development? You have, no disrespect, but obviously you've been in there, and so you can kind of connect the pieces between this
disrespect
generation.
To be, he was smart enough he didn't have to go fight people for a living. So, disrespect.
I'm the straight guy. He's the funny guy. I'm the good-looking guy. He's the guy with the scars. I get it, right?
Yeah. I mean, there's, you know. A lot of my job is really fulfilling. You know, I get to think about it, man. I have the coolest job in the world. If you are not going to be, you know, some awesome philanthropist and, you know, help kids in foreign countries or cure cancer or help children with diseases and shit like that, then the best thing you can do is entertainment. Sports is the best form of entertainment. And, you know, mixed martial arts is the best form of sport. So think about it. All of us in this room, we kind of get to work into sport, and we should realize we're very lucky we get to work in sport. Other people have jobs with, like, accounting stuff, and he has to look at numbers all day and stuff, but at the end of the day, those numbers dictate or determine can be determinants of performance for the coolest sport in the world, right? So, I mean, you know, it's not like we're just looking at data so we can have more numbers on this screen than this screen and, you know, hypothetically we're rich and now we can buy cars that are whatever. We're doing it so we can evolve the sport of MMA, which is pretty cool.
Do fighters request a lot of one-on-one time with you just because you reached the pinnacle? And
I get asked a lot of weird questions that I don't have good answers to.
Like what?
That's, I mean, you know, just again, it's like, you know, well, I want to – you know, I want to be world champ. What do I do? Well, that's like an hour-long conversation, guy. Like, where are you at now? Let's, you know, again, what's happening in your life now? Where you at? What's your camp? What's your physiology like? What's your home life like? How do you set your training up? Mm-hmm. That's the thing I've learned from Bo Sandoval, our strength coach. Every time I ask him a question, there's no easy answers.
You still got, you know, the scion?
You can't maximize one thing without kind of detriment. I do not have the scion.
Okay.
But
that thing was legendary.
It's still
man.
In the family. My father-in-law drives it.
Did you wash it for him before you give it?
No. He cleaned it, left it, and he cleans it. He babies it. He takes great care of it. He's like, you know, a proper car. And it actually looks better now than it ever did when I drove it. And it's got like 170,000 miles on it, and it is going strong.
Very cool. So. All right, guys. Thanks so much for stopping by.
No worries. This was really, thank really
you. I've had to pee for like the last 20 minutes. So.
Yeah, you smoked like four waters.
Yeah. Hydration. It's important. It's a desert out there.
We really appreciate it, and we definitely plan on diving into this and reading it over and over. I'm sure there'll be more questions, so hopefully down the road we can do a part two with you guys.
For sure.
If you have any questions, Duncan's email's in there.
Forrest can be followed on Twitter at Forrest Griffin. Duncan can be followed on Twitter at Duncan French. We're going to take a break. You're listening to MMA Junkie Radio on SiriusXM Rush 93. Stay close. We'll be right back.
says. These guys have none of that. You listen to them, so you're no better. I am awesome, though. They are Gorgeous George and Goes.
Hear your favorite sports from a different perspective on the Vegas Stats and Information Network. VSiN gives you your view from the counter on the only channel broadcasting live from a Las Vegas sportsbook. Follow the money while you follow the games on SiriusXM Channel 204. Odds are you'll like what you hear on the Vegas Stat and Information Network. All right, our next guest, Brian Foster, he will be fighting Ramzi Nijem in the co-main event of PFL 2. You can watch the fights. You can watch the fights on NBC Sports Network, 9 p.m. Eastern Star Time. And again, this is on Thursday in the Chicago Theater in Chicago, Illinois. These are lightweights. And remember, at the end of the year, one of these 12 in each division can win $1 million. Joining us now on the hotline, Brian Foster. What's up, Brian? How you doing?
What's up, fellas? How are you?
Doing great, man. Thanks for asking. Hey, have you spent the million yet? Like, do you think that way? Positive, goal-oriented? I know some do, and some don't even like to think about it. Where do you stand?
It's not something you want to think about, man. I don't think that's... If you're looking at the ending, then you're going to forget about the beginning, and that's going to leave you face-planted. You know what I mean?
Yeah, definitely. All right. Tell me about when you first got the call and they explained to you, hey, this is a regular season format. You got to go out there and try and finish. And, you know, the top eight of the 12 that enter in your weight class will then proceed. One night you got to fight twice. As you started hearing all this and you knew the money at the end, you know, the pot at the end of the rainbow, what was going through your head, man? Like, was this initially something that you just grabbed and said, I got to be a part of it? Or did you have to think about it to see if you could possibly fight five times in those 6 months and sustain and be successful?
It remains the same for me, man. You know, it's one fight at a time. You know, you've only got so many in your career, man. I understand that making the right choices is what it's all about. But, you know, I just kind of found myself here, man. You know, when I was released in the UFC a couple years back, and not a lot of opportunities arose for me after that, and I accepted every opportunity I've always accepted, you know what I mean? But I found myself with World Series, man, and then they changed over to Pro Fight League, and, you know, they described the format and stuff to me, and you know, tournament-style fighting is kind of my thing, man. The more frequent I can fight, the better it is for me. It just kind of fit, man, but to be honest with you, it's just, you know, another opportunity that arises, man, that I just get to kind of take advantage of.
For sure. Brian Foster, our guest here on MMA Junkie Radio, he's in the co-main event slot against Ramzi Nijem on Thursday, this Thursday, folks, and you can watch the fights on NBC Sports Network, 9 p.m. Eastern Start Time. Luis Firmino and Will Brooks is your main event. John Morgan, what do you have for Brian Foster?
Yeah, Brian, I wanted to ask him, you talked about the format of this league, and we're all pretty interested in it. I mean, it was cool to see how the points played out and all that, but, we're kind of wondering if that'll impact people, but I gotta wonder, I mean, you yourself, I mean, you're known as a finisher, so did the way this thing set up, did it change anything in the way you approach fights, or did you just hear about how this points thing was going to go to work and say, oh, hell yeah, that's me all day?
Yeah, absolutely. That's exactly the way I thought about it, man. I just kind of smiled and was just like, good luck, fellas, you know what I mean? Like, you know, it's who I am, man. You know, give me one, give me two, hell, give me three in the same night, and I'm going to try to do my best and take them all out in spectacular fashion, you know?
No doubt.
It's a great format, man. I think that all the fans need to get behind it, dude. It's something of the sort of, if you follow football, man, you follow your team through the season, and you want them to reach the Super Bowl, you know, just like every other league. And I think this gives everybody a great opportunity to follow their favorite fighter and get behind them, follow them through the journey of you know, the social media stuff and see where it takes them. And then at the end of it all, you know, hopefully he comes out victorious, man.
Yeah, I agree. Awesome. We were talking to Carlos Silva yesterday, and I have to admit, the first time I saw the standings after week one, I was like, how cool is that? We know who's in first. We know who's in second. We know who's got to win. I really do love it. I'm excited about it. Brian, you mentioned social media. I wanted to ask you, you tweeted not long ago that you took, I guess, a weekend out to be in a buddy's wedding. I mean, I just want to ask kind of what that's like for you. I mean, to break camp or to take some time off, you know, right before a big fight against a talented guy, you know, with this $1 million prize on the line. I mean, is that a big sacrifice to make, to step out of camp for a day or two, or is it a welcome change to kind of give you a little break from the monotony?
Well, the buddy that I was actually in his wedding was
He's my jiu-jitsu coach. So it wasn't like I was out of camp, you know what I mean? It was actually in Colorado where my camp was. So it was just taking the day off, you know, putting on a suit on, looking good, and going out there and supporting my friends like they come and support me, man. That's what it's all about, brother, is the life, the journey, and the relationships you make along the way. And for him to make me a part of his event, dude, I wouldn't have missed it for the world, you know what I mean? It doesn't affect me or take away from what I'm here to do. It's definitely a good little break in this situation. But even throughout the wedding, I was, you know, getting asked questions and talking about it. And everybody's just so excited, man, and they're ready to see me do what I do, man. You know, I got so much support from so many great people all across the world, man. And I couldn't be more thankful, you know what I mean? And to be in one of my best friend's weddings, and it was a spectacular ordeal, man.
And John makes a great point. 26 of your 27 wins have been finishes. 13 by KO, 13 by submission. So this format is
perfect. There's a lot that's not even on there, too, brother.
Well, we have, but the street fights don't count, Brian Foster. No, I'm just kidding. Hey, one other thing here. Inevitably, you know, because you've dabbled in different weight classes, you are fighting at 55. You're now 34, though. Is it pretty easy cut for you, and how are you handling that?
The last couple of years, I've gotten a lot better at it. You know what I mean? Obviously. Welterweight was where I lived for a long time, and because I never really thought it was a healthy, you know, there was a healthy way for me to get down there. And, you know, as I got older, I just, you know, I studied and I placed myself around the right people, man, smarter people than me that have done it before. And, you know, they led me in the right direction, man, made it easy for me, easier for me. You know, nothing's ever easy.
Right.
When you're cutting weight, it's definitely not the healthiest thing to do sometimes for some people. But when you've wrestled your entire life, man, and you got a great group of people around you that have done it before, then, you know, it definitely makes it easier, man. And we feel that it's just much more beneficial for me, man. I don't have to, you know, muscle around bigger guys. And that's always been my problem. Everybody always contributed the cardio factor to my aggression and how much output I have in the fight. And it really comes down to them big bastards just putting their weight on me and making me move them. And it's just difficult to do that, man. When you got a guy that when you both weigh 170 one day and the next day he jumps back up 25 pounds,
yeah,
and your ass only gains 6, you know what I'm saying? That 15 extra pounds, bro, it'd take a toll on you, you know what I mean? So it definitely affects me. You know, if I didn't get the knockout and I had to wrestle him a little bit, then it would make it a little tougher for me, man. So 55, there's a lot of benefits for me. Mm-hmm. I'm a quicker dude anyway. So, I mean, it just kind of all lines out, man, you know?
Well, at least they made it worth your while. $1 million to the winner. You guys get paid along the way. Great stuff from the PFL. And thank you, sir, for joining us here on Fight Week. We really appreciate it. It's great catching up with you. Good luck on Thursday. We'll be tuning in to PFL 2 on NBC Sports Network.
I sure appreciate it. Thank you.
Okay, take care, Brian. All right, I'd like to welcome to the show now, Sorry.
Oh, I was looking at the
Wow.
Wow.
I didn't even finish it.
We know where you're going.
Hold on a second. I could say Ram fan, longtime Ram fan, Benil Darius. You're a fan of the Rams.
No? Dang, man.
Wow.
What do I do now? Go ahead and call me a fat boy or something.
Nah, you're good. You're good.
We're good?
I'll never forget that, but
No, listen.
In fairness, he is fighting Ramsey Nijem. I get it.
Benil Darius is looking, you know, and so I don't know if he was, like, trying to see, hey, you know, tell me about this fight or something. So I turned it over, and I just pointed there. I saw Ramsey. I know they fought. I know, you know, they're both from the Middle East or what. I'm not trying to say y'all look alike. None of that thing. It's just the name just flowed. But you guys don't know. It could be that he's a longtime Ram fan. So, SoCal, when the Rams came back, you were excited, right?
Super excited.
See?
Yeah. Sure.
I'm good.
He could drive, like, he maybe drives a Dodge Ram.
Yeah.
You never know.
I was just looking over at Luis. Not too familiar with him. That's,
Luis,
that's
from
all.
He's from former Black Zillions. He was on one of the seasons of The Ultimate Fighter when they did Black Zillions versus ATT.
Oh, okay.
Will Brooks, former
I'm familiar with
Bellator
Will.
Champ.
Yeah.
So these are all they're doing, you know, former WSOF. Now they're doing PFL.
Efren's replacing Rashid, right?
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Yeah.
That's disappointing. I really want to see Rashid in there.
Yeah. He's a tough fighter.
How you doing, Benny? Thanks for breaking off from, you know, your boy. I know he had a today's weight cutting.
Today's fight day.
Yeah,
so it's just maybe last minute workout, but thanks for doing that.
Yeah, I mean, we got it done. I told you it's a maybe for me if I'm going to be able to make it, because we got to wake up at 9 and get it done, and then I can come here. If he's not on time, I'm not going to make it, and surprisingly, he woke up.
Jake was here too, so you guys are kind of like assistant coaches for Giga?
Yeah, Jake's here. I think he's just, you know, here for moral support.
Oh, I see.
And then I'm the punching bag this week, which is the easiest job, I guess.
Cordero's the coach?
And then Cordero's the coach, yeah. Okay. You got to have a punching bag when you're cornering, when you have a team.
Well, I felt like because we're both SoCalers and we've had you on many times on the phone, when I heard you were in town, I was like, well, let's see if we can just pull him in here. So, again, thank you for doing the show. How are you doing personally?
I'm doing good. I'm just excited to be back and just training and kind of healthier than before. I was having a little neck thing going on. It was really slowing me down. It's almost 100%, and that alone is enough to make me happy.
Like one of those possible surgery things or how – How in-depth can you get, or do you want to get?
Yeah, it's fine. I don't mind getting in-depth. The surgery thing is weird. They're like, oh, well, you might need surgery, but if you get surgery, you'll never be the same. I was like, what?
Whoa, what's the point of that?
That's the dumbest. That is the dumbest way you can pro somebody, especially an athlete. That. Yeah, they're like, well, you could. It's definitely an option, but you'll never be. I was like, well, then no, I don't want the surgery, and we'll see how it goes. It was something to do with my I was getting a lot of stingers in my left arm, something to do with my is it C4, C5, and C5, C6, like a hernia. But supposedly it's not that crazy. It's just for some reason, based on my anatomy, it was just causing me a lot of problems. But I've been doing acupuncture therapy, physical therapy, massage therapy, chiropractic, like anything with the therapy on it, I've been trying. And it's getting better, and it's getting better quick, so I'm hoping to jump in and fight soon.
Grappling injury or MMA injury?
I think it's just one of those wear and tear ones.
It's a herniated disc, right?
Yeah, something like that.
Okay.
Don't we have a mutual friend in Steve Hanoyan, the nerve therapist guy?
We do, don't
yeah.
we?
Have
yeah.
you seen him? Or
no, I no? should. Okay. That's good idea. But
make up for the yeah. I just want to make sure I'm out of the woods, you know. I got to fight out of that one.
We'll talk about this after.
Take a leg kick or some shit. No, I don't want to take a leg kick. Hey, this is why guy. I brought it up, because Forrest was just here. Did you see him?
Yeah, I didn't see him on the way
out.
We're
talking about how athletes, a lot of fighters feel like, hey, this is what I am, man. I'm from the streets, or you know, whatever. He's faster. He's this and that. And I actually cited you as an example. You came from the grappling world, but you actually completely rounded out your game. A lot of people, when they were breaking down Edson and you, for example, they were like, oh, well, on the feet, Edson all day, on the ground, Benny all day. And you were outstriking him in that fight, you know. I know the fight didn't go your way, but still, like, your improvement, I think it's a testament to your hard work and not just saying, okay, I got to get him down to my world. No, you know what? Let me start beating you at your world. You did that with a lot of fighters, but that's why I don't want to take the leg kick after the show. You definitely have upped your game there.
Yeah, with striking, I mean, I don't really have a choice. Having Rafael Cordero as your coach, you're either going to get better at striking or you're going to get beat down in the gym. And I don't really like getting beat up. So I had to get better.
Mm-hmm. All right. John? I'm good. Oh, no, I'm just kidding. No, seriously, I did want to ask you, like, I mean, coming in and cornering this week, I mean, first of all, I mean, do you enjoy that as something that, or do you feel like it's just a responsibility to be a part of the team, or do you feel like there's something that you can add to the equation? It's something you enjoy.
It's strange. If I do it a lot, I'm like, oh man, I can't do this anymore. Cornering is hard on me. But when I'm sitting at home watching my friends fight, these guys are, you know, like family to me. They're brothers, and I'm watching them fight, and I'm like, man, he should be doing this. If I was just there, and if I could have just done that, and this and that. It weighs really heavy on my heart. So I at the same time, sometimes I don't want to do it. But then when I sit at home, I say I should have been there.
I wonder about that, because yeah, it's just sacrificing a little bit of your time and a little bit of your, you know, your professional career.
Definitely, you sacrifice your time, you sacrifice your body. But at the same time, can you sit at home and be okay with it? That's where I'm kind of stuck at. But I'm figuring it out. One of the toughest things to watch was Hoffa and his last fight. We're not on the same team, but like I said, family. It's bigger than a team. So with that being said, I was like, man, I wish I could have been there. I wish I could have been in this corner. I wish I could have done this. I wish we could have gone over this, blah, blah, blah. It just it runs through your head. You can't help it.
If we just could have got you a seat on press row before you get kicked out.
Yeah, that would have been great.
So I want to ask you, too, about the Dana White's Contender Series, because it's quickly become one of our favorite things to do every week. Just the atmosphere, the kind of the pressure cooker that is of all these guys that are on the verge of maybe getting a USC contract. But it's weird. Like, you got to win the fight, but you got to also impress Dana at the same time. I mean, there's so many variables. So what kind of advice do you give specially to this situation versus just what you might give to Giga on another night?
Normally, I mean, Giga fights a lot of times. He fights kickboxing, and he's a savage in kickboxing. All I got to tell him is, hey, calm down. Don't go nuts. You know, sometimes somebody barely touches him, and he forgets that he can spin. He can do every technique there is in striking, and he just goes straight to brawling. So with that being said, I might say the opposite for this show. I'd be like, you know what, Giga? Just go nuts. Just get in there and find that chin, find that liver, find whatever it is you're looking for, and just take the guy out. I haven't really had an experience with this show yet. I haven't been here. I haven't done this. So I'm going to get a feel for it, and I'm going to be better at it next time.
It's interesting. I love being in that tough gym, just a couple little friends and family on there. It's intense. But I think you're right, because you know, we've seen over the first season, even just the last show, that going out there and putting on a show, styling for 15 minutes, you know, talking, that ain't what he wants to see. I think he wants to see people go out there and steamroll. And if you get the job done in 30 seconds, you might feel like, oh, I didn't get to show who I am. No, get it done in 30 seconds.
Yeah, exactly. The thing with the Giga, too, is he is a showman. Not so much with words, but with his style. He likes to do Rolling Thunder. He likes to spin. He likes to do all of that. So I'm not really sure what Dana's looking for. Does he want Giga to go out there and win this quick? Does he want does he want Giga to spin? We got to get it figured out. That's what I'm interested to see.
It's definitely a fight to watch tonight. When Giga's
actually,
on point, when he's striking.
I should be asking you guys. You guys have been...
We asked the questions here.
Yeah, you guys have more experience. Help me out here.
Benny, I got a question for you. With the injury, with the little bit of a time off, has it been a little bit of a blessing in disguise in the sense of, you're a gym owner now, right? Life has kind of changed in the last couple of years. You got your seminars. I know you can promote that as well. You got one coming up. How's that been for you?
Yeah, the seminar and the seminars in the gym, they're good. The gym, it runs itself. I don't really have to do anything. It's a beast in itself. I have people there. I put people in there that can take care of it, so that way I can focus on fighting. In the beginning, it wasn't like that. I was struggling with, you know, gym and then fighting and then cornering and then seminar. So there's a lot going on, but slowly I'm getting everything in a place where I can just go back to, just fighting. Because that's how it started out. When I first started doing MMA, the only thing I had was fighting, and nobody knew who I was, and it kind of worked out in my favor. Nobody knows who you are, so you want to prove, like, this is who I am. I'm going to show you. So all you do is train. So I'd like to get back to that. That's ideal for me.
George had mentioned earlier in the show we had some of the guys from the Performance Institute here. Can you talk about your experience with them and maybe some takeaways that you had?
Man, those guys are awesome. I know sometimes our athletes kind of, like, they're worried about their secrets being shared or something like that. I don't know what's going on, but there's barriers. But the guys at the PI, they're absolutely amazing. All they want to do is just make you better. Even if it's 1% better, that's all they want to do. So I'm really happy to have those guys there.
All right, so I want to give you some advice here. You were talking about today you're going to be doing the coaching thing.
Yeah.
Remember how you said you're at home and you're saying do this, do that? Yeah. Everyone's going to hear you tonight.
Oh, okay.
Because that gym is an intimate atmosphere.
So yell really loud.
There's going to be about 10 media. There's going to be about, what, there's 10 competitors, mm-hmm.
each person gets four.
Or gal brings four, right?
Yep.
So there's 40, 10 is about 50, and let's tack on 20 extras that just trickled in. We can all hear your corner instructions. We can hear the shit talking between the fighters and everything. So your coaching abilities will have to be on point. We can all hear it.
Yeah, I'm not worried about that. You know what I'm worried about? Well, I hate the sound of my own voice. You know when you do interviews? Yeah, I can't stand it. I feel like, why don't you speak more like a man? Just yell at
me. Hey, Anderson Silva rocked it.
Yeah, right? Well, I guess Shogun too, but shoot, I shouldn't say anything about Shogun. He's probably going to come train with us soon. don't listen.
Yeah. Now you shouldn't trip out on that.
Yeah. Well,
Benny Eldarius, for crying out loud.
That's true. But still don't like my voice. Yeah. I can't help it. It's going to be interesting, man. Today I'm really nervous, but I guess it's good to be nervous. It means you care, right?
Yeah, for sure. And you cited Giga in interviews we had with you as far as, like, who's pushed you. Obviously, your coach, things start with him, but your training partners are the ones that, you know, Friday's murder day, right, over there at Cordero's.
Pay-per-view.
Exactly. It is a pay-per-view. You guys go hard on that day, so you have to be on point.
Yeah, exactly.
And getting better, or your ass is going to get kicked.
Giga is one of those guys for sure. If a lot of stuff you're seeing improvement in striking is also about, because of Giga. He helped me out a lot. Between Rafael Cordero and Giga, my stand-up has just moved up tremendously. So with that being said, I want to repay the favor. I hope you guys get to see some of Giga's grappling, and you guys are impressed because I've been
really?
Working hard with him, yeah, for all grappling.
All right, so just a quick timeout here, and then we'll come back to Benny Eldarius, our in-studio guest. It's been a crazy day here, but we got to get to our next guest. Her name is Brittany Elkin. She will be fighting on Thursday, the same PFL card that I was talking about with Brian Foster a few minutes ago, PFL 2, Thursday night, NBC Sports Network, 9 p.m. Eastern Time. Brittany Elkin will be facing off against Kayla Harrison. She joins us now on MMA Junkie Radio. Danny, can you punch her in, please? Hello, Brittany. How you doing?
Hey, I'm good. How are you?
Good, good. Thank you very much. Thanks for joining us here on the MMA Junkie Radio Show. Brittany, you know, you're facing Kayla Harrison, who's got, you know, her Olympic background. I'm sure a lot of people, a lot of eyeballs are on her, and not only because of her past, but also WSOF, now PFL, brought her in, and she had, you know, some other type of duties. So I wanted to ask you, how do you understand that that's just kind of the role she's in, or have you been able to parlay that into like some sort of motivation, you know, the gal that's getting overlooked and you're ready to spoil the party?
I actually am totally digging the fact that I get to fly in under the radar and she gets to, you know, deal with all the hype and I get to just be me. I am going to spoil the party. That's my plan. But yeah, you know, I'm totally cool with who I am. I like the low flying radar, you know, unannounced chick. That's cool with me.
She does have an Olympic background, but in MMA, she's 0-0, so she'll be debuting. You have 7 fights under your belt. How valuable do you think that experience is that you have over your opponent?
It's an extremely valuable experience. You know, I know that I've became the fighter I am now over the wins and losses that I've taken, and it's not easy getting in there. I know that's, like, incredibly nerving doing anything for the first time, whether it's their first time on a jiu-jitsu mat or first time in an octagon or cage or whatever it is. I think I have the upper hand in MMA.
Brittany Elkin, our guest here on MMA Junkie Radio. Again, she'll be fighting on Thursday night, folks. This Thursday in Chicago at the Chicago Theater, PFL 2, NBC Sports Network with a start time of 9 p.m. Eastern. 6 p.m. on the Pacific time zone, and she will be featured on that main card in the featured bout position just before the co-main event. John Morgan, what you got for Brittany Elkin?
Yeah, I'm curious. I mean, obviously we know about Kayla's Olympic background or her judo skills, but we don't know what she looks like as a mixed martial artist. So I wonder, how do you prepare for somebody like that? I mean, as you're breaking down, do you bother to go back and watch, you know, judo footage or something to see if you can pick up any techniques or tendencies or anything like that? Or does it, I mean, is there no value in that at all?
I'm training with Elevation Fight Team, and my coaches really took that on themselves to prepare me. They brought in a wide variety of girls for me to spar with. I had consistent 8 or 9 girls showing up to all my spars and groundwork for the 12-week camp. It was really awesome to get a bunch of different looks, but I let my coaches do that. They told me they didn't want me to be impressed with Kayla. They wanted me to fight the way I was going to fight, so they'll take a look at the work and make me move toward the direction of fighting her. So I let them do the research and put some trust in them. But, yeah, I fucking trained hard. And one of my main training partners is a judo guy, so I just let him kind of continuously work on me over time. And I feel really prepared for this. I feel more prepared than any of my fights.
I always wonder, too, like, theory-wise, I guess, when somebody is so good at one particular aspect, like, you know you can't necessarily make up the deficit in that one particular area in a training camp. But so I wonder, you know, like, training with a judo person, you know, do you try to, like, drill yourself in judo so that you feel comfortable there if it does go there? Or do you try to say, there is absolutely no way I'm going to get into, you know, a judo-type situation, and I'm going to work everything I can to, you know, if she does get an overhook or if she does work in that clinch, I'm getting away from that position rather than trying to engage in those positions?
Well, I'm obviously not going to catch up on her work of what she's put in judo, but I can be ready to make smart movers into what I favor me and my game. So what we did is a couple tactics to shut down some of her games and then go back to playing mine. When I get in a spot, I have a couple calls that for shutting down her games. I mean, we have a couple of theories, and I'm going to stick really hard to the game plan because I believe in it. I worked hard towards it this whole camp. So,
Goes, what do you have for Brittany Elkin?
Brittany, a lot of fighters say that when they're face-to-face with their opponents, they can play off of their emotions, look into their eyes, and learn a lot. Are you excited for that moment? Do you feel like you'll be able to learn a lot from just the way she is at that moment?
I feel anybody gives off an energy and picks up an energy. I'm ready. I always like that. I like that minute. I like to feel that, you know, the flutter of your heart and the excitement that comes with the weigh-in. So I'm looking forward to that because me and Kayla have never faced off that close. We have passed each other a couple times in the motel this weekend. But I've never been face-to-face yet. I know how much it took for me to get here. I am fully comfortable in the 2 feet that I stand on, so I'm looking forward to face her and feel her energy for sure. I mean, I'm really curious about this fight, too.
Yeah, we can't wait. Thursday night, PFL 2. And, Brittany, let me say, we interview people all the time. You're very poised and composed and calm and concise. Really, really enjoyed the way you conducted the interview. So, from your end. So, thank you very much.
Thank you, guys. Thanks for having me on.
All right. Take care. All right, folks, that's Brittany Elkin. We had Brian Foster on earlier, both fighting on Thursday night, PFL 2. Shout out to Greg Savage for making that happen. All right, let's take that last break of the hour, and then we'll cruise to the finish line with Benil Dariush, who will be cornering Giga tonight. I get all these events confused.
There's a lot going on.
Singapore later in the week. We got PFL on Thursday, and tonight, Dana White Contender Series. There's no other spot you want to be on a Tuesday if you're in Vegas, obviously, to be in that gym. And if not, you got to tune in on the UFC Fight Pass because it is an amazing show. So, anyway, stay close. We'll be right back. And we also have the Daily Debate. You're going to like this one.
And this is MMA Junkie Radio.
Start your day with SiriusXM. Enable the SiriusXM skill on your Amazon device and then tell Alexa to set an alarm for your favorite channel. You'll wake up to the sounds of SiriusXM. With SiriusXM and Alexa, you can get the latest sports news each morning without picking up your phone or turning on the damn TV. All right, let's do the daily debate. Let's get that out of the way. And we get to share it with a UFC lightweight. This is Benil Dariush here in studio with us. Here we go, guys. The question for today is, which UFC pioneer is most glaring omission from the UFC Hall of Fame? You got four choices. Jens Pulver, who's a former lightweight champ. Pedro Hizo, former heavyweight in the UFC, was never a champion, though. Frank Shamrock, who's a former light heavyweight champ, because at the time it was 170, 200, and over. And defended, all, by the way, four times, if I'm not mistaken. Oleg Tektarov, who won a tournament and was also he also drew in a super fight, and so he was, you know, those were pretty legit stats back in the day, because winning a tournament was pretty comparable to, hey, at one point I was a champ, even though they didn't really have that.
He has a bad movie record, though.
He does, yeah. So let's start at the very end. You'll go last, Benil, because we don't like your voice very much. John Morgan, what do you think?
Listen, all very deserving candidates, but I think the one that stands out for me is Frank Shamrock. I think, you know, you look at his accomplishments in the sport, but not only that, kind of what he represented. You know, we talk about those early days, the developments, you know, where you could mark those milestones of, well, it was jiu-jitsu, well, it was wrestling, well, we saw Elite Strike. To me, he was the first, you know, kind of complete mixed martial artist all the way around, approach things that way, you know, had kind of a scientific look at how to approach training, how to approach preparation for fights. So to me, just what he represents in whole, I got to go Frank Shamrock. Hurts me because Oleg Tektarov was a beast early in the day, so that'd probably be number two to me, just as like the Sakuraba one we had thrown in there last year. But, yeah, I think Frank Shamrock's a glaring omission. Hope that one gets fixed.
All right. How about you, Benny?
I got to go with Jens. He started a division. If it wasn't for his fight with BJ Penn and things like that, I don't know if we'd have the lightweight division as quickly as we did.
I feel like Jens is somewhere listening going, that's what I'm talking about right there. All right, so I actually want to piggyback on what John said. Frank Shamrock, you know, when he fought Tito Ortiz, was one of his big fights. Tito Ortiz, if you put those guys next to each other, man, that's why one guy fought as a 205er and the other guy fought as an
805er. They ain't the same size.
Right, but he out-cardioed him, you know what I mean? So he brought that, and he opened Tito's eyes. Next thing you know, Tito's buying a spot out in Big Bear. I think he bought De La Hoya's spot, and he was like, I got to become a cardio machine, and he did. So Frank Shamrock definitely changed the game. All due respect to Jens Pulver, for sure, the best lightweight at some point, you know, in the early 2000s. But I think what makes the difference for me is Shamrock had those title defenses. And I'm a big believer in, like, winning it, and then now let's see what you've done with it. And if you look at the UFC champions, they start to separate themselves, you know. GSP, Anderson, Demetrius, those guys are at the top. And those are some of the guys that are always involved in GOAT talk. But just below them, you have another wave of fighters that were awesome, just like a Frank Shamrock or a Matt Hughes or, you know, some of the other champions, obviously, that graced our sport. So that's my choice. How about you, guys?
Well, there are no wrong answers, and I think it's going to be 2-2 here. I'm going to go with Jens Pulver, and the only thing that took me over for the longest time, I was with you guys, Frank Shamrock. I started thinking about it, though. When you encompass WEC, you encompass Pride, even he had a fight there, I believe, and he was a coach on The Ultimate Fighter, and as Benny stated, he basically pioneered a weight class. That was what took me over the edge. So I'm going to go with Jens Pulver.
Yeah, and you know, quick plug for Jens. In the end, he fought as a 35er, so he was even an undersized 55er. You know what I mean? But still wound up getting that belt. All right, so let me share here the final results. 61% actually said Frank Shamrock. 23% came in for Jens Pulver. 10% for Pedro Hizo. And 6% for Oleg Tektarov.
Oleg getting no love.
That one stings. I love Oleg Tektarov, man.
910 of you voted. Thank you very much for participating. And that's today's Daily Debate, brought to you by the MMA Junkie Radio Team and Benil Dariush. Benil, all right. So after this, you go back home and training. Things training as usual.
Yeah, try to stay skinny, like you were saying. I'm looking extra meaty right now.
That's what we're best on giving advice about.
Yeah, like you said, get back to work, get back to training. Just focus on training. That would be ideal for me.
Do you think you'll have something lined up?
As soon as I feel my neck is not like every practice, I'm not stuck at my shoulder to my ear, then I'd love to fight right away.
Okay.
What's the attitude going to be when you get back in there? I wonder, because I know March was not fun for you. It was frustrating for a lot of different reasons.
Man, it's not even just March. The fight before that. I've been just sucking. That's the that's the truth of it. I'm in a big drought, and with that being said, I'm just hungry. I'd like to go out there and just beat somebody up really, really, really good. That would be ideal. Just tear somebody's head off.
And, you know, if a team in baseball loses...
Well, that's Megan Fox. No, I'm just kidding. I just want to see what his neck injury was all about. See how fast he turned?
Yeah, that wasn't so bad. Yeah.
I couldn't even make a full turn. What are you talking about?
You see how fast he turned that
He did. all I was going to say was it's unfortunate for you guys because you have to wait 3-6 months to get that taste out of your mouth. You know what I mean? A baseball guy can shake it off and then come in the next day and all's well. But, dude... You started off 7-0. You got to 12-1, 14-2. Just remember, man, you're one of the baddest lightweights in the world. You've beaten Rashid Magomedov. He's only lost twice. You gave him one of those. James Vicks won 9 in a row. You were the last guy to beat him. And then, you know, Michael Johnson, Jim Miller. These are fucking tough outs. So I know you're in a little bit of a spin here, but get the neck healthy and then just get back to being Beneil Dariush. You're one of the best in the world, bro.
Yeah, I appreciate it, man. Like you said, the record, the wins, those are important, but our sport, it's the last one that really matters, and the last one sucked. So.
You'll get there, my man. Thanks for stopping by the studio. We really appreciate it. Good luck to you and Team Giga tonight. And folks, tonight, Dana White Contender Series. Check it out on the UFC Fight Pass. You won't regret it. In fact, I think they got some sort of a special right now where they reduced a little bit of that $9.99 spread out. It's like $6 for the next 3 months or however long this thing lasts. You'll really, really dig it. Take our word on that. All right, for John and Dan and Danny and Goes and Benny, I'm George. Go out there and be a champion.